Thanks, Darren, and thanks everyone for coming out. It's obviously not a sparkling sunshine day, but I appreciate you all coming to hear what I have to say about my trip. So I graduated my Bachelor of Architecture in 2016 from Newcastle Uni, and I'm currently in fifth year. So I was the 2018 recipient of the Parker Fellowship, and it was the year in 2019 that I undertook my travel. So Darren sort of touched on what the Parker Fellowship's all about, but you basically get this opportunity to travel anywhere in the world that you want and look at any sort of idea that interests you, and it's this incredible opportunity. I believe, and I think it still is, the highest awarding scholarship for architecture students in Australia, and it's only offered at Newcastle Uni, so I definitely encourage anyone to apply if you're eligible. Just a bit about me. I'm from regional New South Wales, a place called Clarencetown, which is out towards Dungog, which some of you may be familiar with. I grew up one of five kids, and on a big property we had heaps of space, a river, and had this totally different upbringing to then what I'm about to talk to you about. So then I migrated to the coast for uni, like a lot of young people do, and obviously came to Newcastle to study architecture. And through study, I got other travel experiences like visiting Japan and Singapore. And these things all started to fuel this idea of cities and how cities work. And I've always felt like a bit of like an outsider looking in because I'm not from this world, so I find it really interesting. And the way we sort of plan space and use space versus, you know, super dense places like Hong Kong. So, you know, what's some sort of middle ground? How can we consolidate the two and come up with a solution that would work for a place like Newcastle, which is going to sort of skyrocket in population in the next 50 years? And how do we account for that density? And that sort of led to my research question, can the densification of cities be the catalyst for urban regeneration? You know, can we have an outcome that works for allowing for this density and makes for a habitable city and a nice place to be in, and not this kind of idea of scary density and skyscrapers and high rise and everything? So I started first off looking at population densities across the world, and I knew I wanted to visit Europe because we sort of have this cultural association with Europe, and it's tends to be a place we reference when we think about ideas about architecture and urban planning. But then I was also really interested in what Southeast Asian cities could offer as a completely different perspective. And so I wanted to kind of have the two to compare and broaden my knowledge to get a better idea of like how people deal with this across the world. So I selected six countries to visit, and I traveled for 4 months. This was my first time traveling solo ever, which was pretty daunting and was definitely a lot more work than I thought it would be as I was going, but it was an amazing experience. So I started off in Vietnam, which has a pretty massive population of 97.4 million. And it's got this extreme density at this really small fine-grained scale at the street, which is really cool. They also have a motorbike population of 45 million. Bikes and vehicles dominate the streets, and you know, you can't really avoid them. You hear them, they're everywhere. There's kind of this flow of traffic that works somehow, but it seems very chaotic. And bikes have just become this sort of essential commodity to the way people live their lives there. You know, they're much more than a vehicle. They transport goods and become like point of sale, and so people take advantage of that. But they definitely don't only dominate the streets. People have taken their sort of claim to the street as well. So there's this real negotiation of public space where people kind of occupy spaces in these sort of ways that's a very like informal nature. You know, they probably don't necessarily have permission to be in that space or to own that space, but they kind of do in various ways. You know, some places, as the day goes on, the markets kind of slowly creep up and take over the whole road, and then there's some more sort of informal seeming temporary structures that have been there for many years. An example of that is Train Street in Hanoi. So this street became popular with tourists because there's this train going through this tiny little space, and locals saw that as an opportunity to make sort of commercial businesses along there. So what was a back of house sort of service route then became this iconic destination in Hanoi for people to visit, and people set up their businesses and realign their shop fronts to face towards Train Street. And even you can see in some of the images some shop fronts that are only like 1 to 2 meters wide, and they've just kind of squeezed out every bit of space they can to like make a bit of money and use that. And I believe now, since I've come back, they've closed this off from tourists because it's dangerous, but I can't confirm that one. And then the occupation of existing buildings, and again, just this idea of commodity and business and making money. And I just thought this was a really interesting building where all these different businesses have kind of plugged into this existing kind of concrete structure. And then in contrast to some places like heritage area Hoi An, which is a much more refined version of what you see elsewhere, versus the more streets of Hanoi, where it's this very like adaptive quality for the architecture, and people sort of like take care of the street as if it was a private space, even though it's public, but it's still a very shared kind of place. You know, everyone hangs out there, and the architecture itself. The architecture has this additive quality, and every building is different, and they sort of, you know, if we need an awning there, we'll put one there and we'll add all these parts, and it creates for this really diverse streetscape and a really active streetscape combined with, you know, all the movement of the vehicles on the road. That's a very interesting and cool place to visit. So then my trip took me to the Philippines. So the Philippines was the most densely populated area I visited on my trip, and Manila being the most densely populated cities and one of the most densely populated cities in the world, with 45,000 people per square kilometer. So the history of Manila is that it was almost completely destroyed after World War II. It was actually the second most devastated city in the world. And so after this time, there was a push to rebuild, to house people and promote economic recovery and independence. And so there was this haste to redevelop the city. That combined with political reasons, there wasn't an adoption of like a strict urban plan or how they were going to actually foresee that this city would function for the population in the future. And so you kind of get in some parts of the city this real lack of infrastructure and public transport, and that has knock-on effects of class segregation, lack of pollution and sanitation issues. But I found that in between all of the high rise and the chaos of the streets, a real sense of community. So I was based in the area of Makati for about a week, which is right in central Manila. And I was there during Fiesta, which is a celebration that they have every year. And the streets were so vibrant and people were so welcoming and just wanted you to be a part of their little community. And while you're there, you sort of forget that it's one of the most densely populated cities in the world, because it feels like tight-knit, like it's a community. So they had all sorts of activities and things going on for the week that I was there, during the day and at night. This really nice sort of performance of karaoke, where everyone just drags their TV out from their house and brings it into the street, and people just gather around, and we were walking past and people would just be like, come on, come and sing a song, like we've got Western songs. And it was this really cool experience. But then there's also the reality of, because of that lack of infrastructure and urban planning, you get these outcomes where there are slums in the sort of least desirable parts of the city. And in a lot of these parts, they actually back onto gated communities and a more traditional westernized suburb, which is unfortunate. I then moved on to Malaysia, focusing on the area of Peninsular Malaysia, which is so richly diverse in its culture and food and architecture, and has influences from all over the world. Oh, air conditioners? As a kind of almost a decoration for the facade. They stood out here the most, so I took photos of them. The one in the middle has over 100. I did count it at one point. But it's sort of like, this is how we're servicing our buildings and we need this, so let's put it here. You know, there's no hiding it around the corner or anything. It just is what it is. So this is the town of Malacca, which is a heritage town down south. And it's really defined by these beautiful shop top houses and street art. And just some examples of traditional housing there. Across Malaysia, but particularly in places like Malacca and Georgetown, which is then up north, there's this real culture surrounding food and eating out. And this sort of almost links back to the idea of commodity and vehicles in Vietnam, where like in the evening or at night, people kind of flock to the streets to all these carts that are selling particular dishes. There was one where it's just this old couple, they might have been 80 years old, and you know, the husband was cooking all the noodles and putting them in bowls, and then the wife was chopping up the ingredients and serving and taking the money. And it's just like this really nice culture surrounding food, where it's a shared experience and people come out into the city. You know, no one sits at home and has a meal. And then extended into the hawker restaurants, which are kind of dotted all over Malaysia, which are a more formalized version, where, you know, you basically just have a shed roof or something like this, and different stall holders just come in and provide a whole range of food. And it becomes a real, really community oriented area where they have entertainment, and, you know, that's where you meet up, and it's this really cool culture. And then in Georgetown, I guess a bit of a critique on what's happened there. It was announced as a World Heritage Site in 2008, which is seen probably on face value as a positive thing. But because of that, the rent in the area increased by 200% to 300%. And what happened then was this introduction of a linear structure actually forced residents out because people couldn't afford to be there. So a lot of these old shop houses have kind of gone into disrepair, or they're just sitting there unused. And so now it's more of a tourist hub, or a place for people who have the money to afford it, which goes against, you know, cities should be for everyone, not just for people with money. And that also leads to the gentrification of that city as well. And then people push out into areas like Ipoh, which is similar to how Georgetown started, maybe with a bit less of the heritage architecture, but a lot of buildings and places that are not as well kept, a lower SES sort of group. But then, it's not working. but then you start to get these pockets of new residents coming in and creating a similar sort of cultural experience there and activating these small parts of the city. But I guess as a critique, what's then stopping that from the same thing that happened in Georgetown happening here, where it becomes its own worst enemy and people get forced out again? I then moved on to Europe, and in hindsight, I was really glad that I did structure my trip this way, because I obviously had a particular experience in Southeast Asia, and then coming to Europe was a totally new thing, so it definitely like refreshed me, gave me some new eyes of how to look at things. And I started in France, and particularly in Paris, which is an incredible place. It has this beautiful, consistent historical architecture throughout. This really consistent language and this culture of, I call it like the culture of the corner cafe, where every sort of corner is dotted with some sort of cafe. And I was there during summer, so people flock to these places at all sorts of times of day and sit on the street. You always sit on the street, never inside, and all the seats are orientated out towards the street, and people watch and just kind of engage in the street in a similar way to what I saw in Southeast Asia, just much more formalized. And then I saw a couple of icons on the way, Le Corbusier, which was definitely worth the painful trip to get there for anyone who's been there. But no, this, I just wanted to throw in a couple of kind of architectural gems on the way, because while you're doing this study and you're learning about whatever your interest is on the scholarship, you get to see these things as well. So this is in Lyon, so this is in eastern France. And there you can see clearly the language of the formal Paris streets and every building being quite consistent starts to change. So it becomes a bit less formal. There's a bit of a greater connection to landscape and parks, which then flows into places like Annecy, which is a much smaller village. And I guess as I added these places in, they weren't in my original itinerary, because as I was traveling, I realized it was important to visit a range of places, not just the densest city in that country or, you know, the biggest area. It was important to see like how that place and that culture operates on multiple scales. And that one's just in Menton towards the Italian coast, and this kind of, it kind of links back to that additive sort of architecture that I was interested in Southeast Asia. And then this is a town of Ayrs, a medieval town on top of a sort of huge cliff face up near the water, sort of near Nice. And the same sort of ideas of like reflecting on this heritage architecture and how they did things versus then like Paris, which was a bit more modern in the way they structured their environment. Then moved on to Spain. So Australia is actually 15 times bigger than Spain, but has less than half of the population. And I started in Bilbao with obviously the infamous Guggenheim, which is known to be the kind of icon that fueled the Bilbao effect, which was using a single building to, as a catalyst to kind of reinvent an entire city. And so that combined with like cleaning up industrial land in the port and introducing a transport system, which was done by Norman Foster, sort of revitalized this city and put it on the map. And it was at the age of technology, so people are just starting to see advertisements for places like this, and they see this building and they go, wow, I need to go and visit that, like that's amazing. And it's sort of built itself totally off that, but it definitely has so much more to offer than just that. It's a beautiful city, and the streetscape is a bit more like Eastern European, and it's very interesting and very different to any other city I visited in Spain. And then Barcelona, again, had to pop in the architectural gem. If you're ever there, go in the afternoon, because you get the full experience of the stained glass. And the view from one of the towers over the city, where you see the structures of the super blocks, sort of, which was a revolutionary urban scheme at the time, which has its merits and its disadvantages. And then I was there in August, so I was lucky enough to be there during the Festival de Gracia, which is a week-long festival where they do all of the human tower building, and there's parties and streetscapes, and people, different communities and streets will band together and they theme a street and decorate it, and they spend a whole year planning their decorations for this occasion. These really elaborate streets that have, you know, all these, like there was an underwater one and they had a full shark and all this stuff going on, and so all these kind of decorated streets meet up and join up to public space and courtyards, which is where you have the people partying and playing music and all sorts of activities. And it was again, that sort of sense of community in a place that is so big. And then just moving south and experiencing some of the architecture down there. It's pretty iconic, the details in that, which I just thought you guys would appreciate. And finishing off in Sevilla, And then lastly, I headed to England. And so I found that London just has this beautiful mix of old and new. It was a bit different to any other city, like Spain and Paris, where it's all sort of heritage, and this one really like starts to merge those two and kind of give the qualities of what a modern city needs to function with the beauty of the heritage buildings like dotted in between. Pub culture in London. So every afternoon people flock to the pubs and occupy the corner in a similar way to the cafes in Paris, and yeah, they kind of take over the whole street. Cars just avoid that area because you can't get around all the people, and it's just this really nice experience. And this is in Manchester. So Manchester was one of the first industrialized cities in the world, and it left behind all of these incredibly detailed brick buildings, which are essentially warehouses. And then people have come through and kind of done some adaptive reuse and repurpose these buildings for new functions. And it's filled with beautiful architecture and, yeah, people utilising the space. That one on the left is all bars. So overnight, this one strip under this lock that's just filled with bars and activity, and it's a really good use of the space. And then some of the more regional areas of England, sort of York, Bath, Leeds, and how in their own sort of way they start to address the street with their ornate little facades that sort of come into that public space. And I just thought they're really beautiful, and you sort of see them across England. And then to finish off, I came back to London. I think this was my second last day of my trip. So I've been traveling for 4 months. I'm pretty exhausted, ready to go home. And then I came here and I was like, oh, this is so good. Like, you know, it was really nice to have that breath of fresh air right at the end. And I think it's a good one to finish on, because the Barbican Centre was kind of envisioned as this utopian vision to transform London, and plans to extend out beyond its boundaries. And it's a really beautiful and complex piece of architecture that incorporates so many like mixed uses, and originally was designed to house people of all sorts of backgrounds and statuses, and yeah, sort of has that diverse culture surrounding it. So that's it. So yeah, like Darren said, the applications close on the 16th of March for the 2020 recipient. I absolutely recommend applying if you can, even if you're not sure, if you have a strong idea, just go for it. You know, this was the third time I had applied for the scholarship and eventually became successful. Familiarise yourself with that process, and yeah, if anyone actually has any questions about that process or moving forward or how to approach any ideas, I'm more than happy to talk to you after this or at the studio or anything. So thank you.